Hi everyone, it's Steve. I made this video to show you something I've been working on. It's the star-shaped LED display and the particle emitter animation shown here. I wanted to build a project to freshen up my Python programming skills, and I happened on this idea while setting out my Christmas lights for 2018. This portion of my current yard display is 18 years old. These old stars are made from 70s era mini lights that have been attached to wireframes made from good old shirt hangers. There's lots of duct tape and zip ties holding everything together in classic do-it-yourself style. Red-green would approve. The mechanical thermal blinkers fail pretty often, and sometimes a finger flick is what it takes to get them going. But debugging other bulb and wiring failures is with a multimeter is a brain-racking and labor-intensive endeavor. I want to move this old display out of the 70s and really get fancy using individually addressable LED pixels.
I chose the World Semi WS2812B as the pixel component for this design. Each pixel includes three internal LEDs, a red, a green, and a blue, along with a built-in controller. The controller can set each of the three LEDs to one of 256 brightness levels. The 2812s operate from a 5-volt supply, and each has a data-in and data-out pin for the serial control protocol. The components are daisy-chained by their ins and outs, with only three wires needed between each pixel. I think less wiring means less chance for wiring problems. I picked BTF Lighting's IP65 strips due to their low cost and waterproof design. I really like the simplicity of the flexible strip. I'm not sure if the components they use are actual 2812s, but they are compatible with the protocol. I'm using the black 30 pixels per meter variety in this project. The strips have a thin double-sided tape backing, but I don't think it will hold up too long in an outdoor environment. The layout was carefully planned with a few constraints from the old display. I wanted to keep a similar star size, have pixels at the tips, and avoid overlapping pixels in the middle of the star. I used a quick scratch program to verify my layout ideas using Turtle or Pen Graphics. I decided on a strip of 45 pixels and cut it into 5 9-pixel sections. Each section forms part of a 10-pixel cord that includes the start of the next strip. The BTF strips need a support structure to hold them in the star shape. I decided to design my own plastic strip that could be 3D printed and then assembled into the star shape. I came up with a star strip design and modeled it in Tinkercad. The ends of the strips snap together and have slots to accept zip ties that securely hold the pixel strips in place. I found a mail order supplier on TreatStock and had my parts printed in ABS plastic. I unexpectedly specified 20% infill on the order, but that worked out okay, with the strips being somewhat flexible for the woven assembly I wanted. There are plenty of choices for LED pixel controllers. For me, the Raspberry Pi works great. I have a Raspberry Pi Model 3B. I'm running Raspbian, also known as Debian Stretch, Linux. The Pi is inexpensive and out of the box. It offers a bunch of learning opportunities with free open source software and development suites. Included HDMI, USB ports, Wi-Fi, and Bluetooth make this a standalone computer that runs from a 5-volt wall wart. I'm using Maniacal Labs' awesome BiblioPixel light programming system to run the display. Their open source Python 3 code library is hosted on GitHub. The package supports multiple pixel types, is portable to multiple operating systems, and comes with a lot of example animations. They support pixel layouts for one-dimensional strips, two-dimensional matrices and disks, as well as three-dimensional cubes. The animations are customizable via project files written in YAML or JSON. I was able to start with their animations very quickly using their built-in strip layout. I had my own animation ideas for this star and was able to program my own animation in Python. More on that later. There's one more component between the Raspberry Pi and the pixel strips. That's Maniacal Labs' All-Pixel Mini. It's a USB device that handles the serial protocol that updates the pixel colors. This frees the Raspberry Pi of that CPU overhead and allows other real-time event-driven software to coexist in the system. In my setup, the All-Pixel Mini provides just the data signal to the pixel strips. A ground connection is also required to make sure all the ground levels are common between the Raspberry Pi, the power supply, and the All-Pixel Mini. Each 9-pixel strip is wired to the next with a 3-wire connection for 5 volts ground and data. The strips have solder pads on the back that let you keep the waterproof covering stuck to the LED side. I also added adhesive lined heat shrink tubing after soldering to keep the connections waterproof for outdoor use. These 3-pin waterproof connectors work great for connecting the display to the power supply and the all-pixel harness. I plan on using the same connectors to daisy chain the stars when I scale this up. Each star of 45 pixels draws 1.66 amps at 5 volts with all the LEDs of each pixel at full brightness, and 32 milliamps in the quiescent off state. This 30 amp supply drives the LEDs directly without going through the all-pixel board. So let's go over the emitter animation. I'll demonstrate it on this strip to talk through some of the underlying concepts and then move on to the star display. This is the emitter animation running at 4 frames per second. When I first imagined the star display, I was thinking of the way fireworks looked. You've probably seen animations that use particle systems to simulate fireworks. The firework explodes with glowing particles being emitted from a point. The particles then flicker and fade before they burn out, and this animation is similar. The emitter animation is a one-dimensional particle system for BiblioPixel. The animation is written in Python. My emitter class inherits from BiblioPixel's strip animation class. The emitter class has lots of parameters to control the particle effects, and the source code contains doc strings describing the parameters. Definitely check that out. The parameters can be overridden in BiblioPixel's YAML or JSON project files. Each strip can have multiple emitters with programmable positions and velocities. Particles can be emitted in either or both directions. This demo has one stationary green emitter with emitted particles moving in the positive direction down the strip. Moving emitters and particles can wrap at the end of the strip, and they can be invisible or have color like this one. Emitted particles move away from the source, starting at the full brightness of a color that's randomly selected from a palette. The palette for the particles in this demo is one I call Rocket. It's like rocket flames. It contains just 3 colors, gold, orange, and red. Once emitted, the particle brightness then varies in a random manner. The random variations are chosen from a list built at class initialization. The default settings should make the particles sparkle and fade. The distribution of brightness variations is adjustable. In this demo, the mean brightness delta is 32 levels down per frame. Individual particle velocities are random with adjustable constraints. The average velocity of the particle in this demo is 0.75 pixels per frame. Particles have a range, and they won't go beyond a specified distance in pixels. Here, the range is 20 pixels. At a given frame step, an emitter can start multiple particles. The starts at once parameter controls how many can start. The value here is just 1. The starts prob parameter controls the probability that a particle will actually start. The value here is 0.5. The variance in particle velocities lets particles overtake each other as they travel down the strip. Particles can hold a brightness level below 0 and then randomly come back above 0, becoming visible again. These are the zombie particles that lurk below the surface and then come back to life. Another effect is flares. The flare probability parameter specifies the probability that a particle can immediately return to full brightness before resuming the random brightness variations. This animation uses the default value of 0.05 that is further divided by the number of pixels in the animation size. The particles are rendered onto the strip screen at each animation step. A loop goes through all the strip's pixels and sees what particles or emitters are visible from that spot. If no particles are visible, the background color is used. In this case, it's a very dark blue. The aperture parameter controls the visibility distance. If the distance to a particle is outside the aperture distance, it does not contribute to the pixel. The colors of the visible pixels are then blended based on the distance to the given pixel. Particle positions, distances, and apertures are all floating point values. Small aperture values can cause blinking when a particle or emitter becomes invisible between the pixel locations. Larger aperture values will spread the pixel's color across multiple pixels. This demo uses an aperture of 0.75. Okay, so let's go over this animation on the star display. I'm going to start up BiblioPixel with a demo project file that uses the sequence animation to run several different parameter sets for the emitter animation, one after another. Each animation is going to run for 15 seconds to show the visual effect before moving on to the next one. I'll provide a link to the project file in the notes. And then I'm going to dim the lights to help the camera pick up the colors better. The first animation is called Outward. It uses the rocket palette with particles that come out of the 10 stationary unidirectional emitters located just inside the pentagon corners and outward towards the tips. Here's blue sparkles with a blue palette and particles emitted bidirectionally inward from the tips. The particle range is 5. Defaults is what you get when no parameters are specified. Gold-colored particles that range over the entire pixel strip. Three Comets uses the rocket palette and three moving emitters on a dark blue background. Violet is like blue sparkles, but in violet with moving emitters. Comet has a single visible moving emitter that's white with blue particles of range 10. Five Crayons shows five moving unidirectional emitters with different single color palettes and a range of 5. Red, White, and Blue contains 5 moving red emitters and a blue particle palette. Pulsating, a faster 5 comet version of the 3 comet parameter set. Star War, single particles emitted bidirectionally from stationary visible emitters at the tips. Pew pew pew! No, there's no collision detection. Long range blend. Stationary emitters with particle tails that extend into the next emission zone. The particle range is 15, but the emitter spacing is 9. Blender. I turned on the emitter motion and increased the aperture from 0.75 to 1. It blends. And now we're back to the start of the sequence. Thanks for watching.